Selamat pagi.
I like that. I wish everybody is a very fine morning. The people who come from very, very far away from the geographical viewpoint, because nowadays the meaning of far away is changing. So, welcome to Jakarta. And guys, there is one person in this room who for the first time come to Jakarta. Is it good or is it sad? I want to cry for that. Software architecture, that is the point that first two words that was given to me by the organizer. Software architecture, what is it? I started always my life every single day with a smile, surrender to the Almighty, and relax. And today, I wanted to do that. The only thing that make me smile this morning is the words software architecture. It reminds me a very, very good story. In the mid-70s, when the word software architecture perhaps firstly introduced, and I believe 99% of you non-exist yet in mid-75. At that time, the university that I was a student in, they announced that we have a collection of books on computer. And among the list, it is said software architecture. Since it is a very hot topic, everybody rush in to the library looking for the book so-called software architecture. None of them can find the book, because in their mind, when they are talking about computer architecture, they are seeking the book in the racks whereby all the computing books were stored. You know what happened? One person finally find the book, and the book was stored in the collection of the Faculty of Architecture. So that the one that make my life today is a beautiful day. Remind me of the good old days in campus. Software architecture. Since then, I don't understand what is computer architecture except the good story in the library. Let me start, since retirement in late 2009, I've been embracing a new life. I call this, I'm completing the circle of ABG. Bukan anak baru gede, but the academician, the business, and the government. I was in the academics for more than two decades and entered the government for 5 years and later entering the new world, the business. So I'm completing, since late 2009, I'm completing the loop of A, B, and G in the business. And the business that I've been active on electrical power generation. It's nothing to do with this software architecture. So I'm becoming far away from your life, the computer architecture. But if I take the analogy, you are dealing with the elephant, I've been dealing with the snake, and I'm now forced by these good guys, good friends, to be standing here. I look for the similarity. What will be the similarity that when I'm talking about the snake, the people who understand the elephant, they can also understand. So I look the components of the elephant, then start smiling. Oh, the trunk look like the snake. The tail look like the snake. Okay, then I can go on with the story of the snake and the elephant. In any organization, you name it, the startup, the growing company, the well-established corporation, there are six similarities of all of them. I call this the six M's. It used to be called five M's. In Japanese, we call it Molimo. The original five M's, remember what are they, the five M's? The money, the method, the machineries, you call it technology now, it used to be called machineries, the manpower, and the material, the molimo, five M's. And then, about a decade later, after those five M's were introduced, the six M coming in, they said those five M's will be powerless, will be meaningless, will be nothing if the six M will not be present, namely the market. Remember the joke about Tetuko? In Indonesia, we started to produce the aeroplane. It's so difficult to sell. And there was a joke. And that the first plane that we claim being the highest local content, it is given name Tetuko. Tetuko is given, is taken from the Japanese culture, the wayang. So before Gatot Kaca is able to fly, the name was Tetuko. But then it was misunderstood for the sake of the joke. They said Tetuko is the people who teko ora tuku-tuku, the people who are potentially to do tuku, they don't come. Sing tuku ora teko, sing teko ora tuku. So that is the meaning. So if the market is not there, irrespective how good your five M's, it will not be a successful business. Whether you are the startup, the growing company, expanding company, or the well-established multinational corporation. If only I distribute a quiz, a piece of paper, you choose out of these six, which one is now the most relevant? I would like to throw the quiz. Since I was a lecturer, quiz is part of my life. It's in my blood. Raise your hand if you say, I will read the six M's. Raise your hand if you said that is the most important for you. The first one is the money. Raise your hand. None. Only one. Okay, he's the money man. Two. Okay, another money man. No money female? No. Okay. Oh, yes, three. Who will say the machineries or the technologies that are most important? None. Oh, one, finally. Method, metoda, cara, technique. Who will say method is the most important? Okay, one, two, three, four, five, six. Did you raise your hand two times? The most important, money and method. So you have two. It's okay. There is no wrong answer, only wrong question. Who will say that material, ini material dalam arti sebenarnya bukan matre, ya, material, bahan baku atau bahan-bahan semi jadi. Who will say material is the most important? None. Who will say the market is the most important? Okay, roughly 20% of the room say market is the most important. How far are we already? 5 or 4? 5, okay. The last one, manpower. Men in the most general meaning, including women. I'm not trying to be gender focused, okay. Men in the most general meaning. Because I never be able to translate manhole. Nobody call it womanhole, right? Or manual. Nobody call it womanual. History. Nobody will say her story, although I know the reason why. Because history can be made short. Her story will be much longer. Is that true? Who will say manpower is the most important? Alhamdulillah. Yes. The latest book written by Mannings and Carson from the famous consulting company, Bain and Company. The book entitled Talent, Time, and Energy. In that book, the book is not a theoretical book. It's a survey. Survey in the real sense. Not just survey like what you heard lately in Jakarta or in Indonesia. No, don't forget those survey. The real survey. They did the survey in 5 continents, in big corporation. What are the most important out of these 6? Yes, as you raise your hands, majority, that manpower nowadays in the world of Industry 4 is the most crucial. Let's take the case of Indonesia. Manpower. We do have plenty of people, plenty, you name it. Some people say 260 million people. So many. And yet, if you come to each human resource department or people who are dealing with human resource department, they will say the most difficult time for them is now. Namely, to look, to recruit, to hunt, whatever word you want to say, the right people. So they use the right people. It doesn't mean all left, no, no. The right people mean the person who is suitable with the criteria that they want. Their criteria is simple. The people with the sufficient competency and the people with the good character. Only 2 character. And yet, the gap between the available people in Indonesia, either they are the high school leavers, university graduates, it's so difficult. The mismatch between the available people with the set of people who are needed with the company, with the NGOs, with the government, you name it, the gap is so wide. It's getting wider and wider. I think what you sacrifice today, I call this a sacrifice. To me, the gray hair people, Saturday is not here. It's outside there. You go, you walk, you enjoy it. Only you, the millennials, who are willing to sacrifice Saturday, sitting nicely, watching seriously, listening ambitiously. Not on my age, no. Saturday, nah. Nah. So why the gap is so different, is so big? Let's pay attention to the Indonesia case. The duo proclamators, President Sukarno and Wakil President Hatta, when they declared, they made the Constitutional Act, Undang-Undang Dasar 45, there is a clause, ada pasal yang mengatakan wajib hukumnya bagi pemerintah mengalokasikan 20% dari APBN untuk pendidikan. Perhaps Indonesia is within 4 to 6 countries in the world who really put numbers in their constitutional act to be allocated for education. I would say we'll not be more than 6, and Indonesia is one of them. 20% dari APBN itu untuk pendidikan. Kalau APBN kita 1.400 triliun, gede banget tuh uang. Kenyataannya seperti itu? Tidak. Mengapa demikian? Karena sekali lagi lah, alasan yang mendasar adalah kebutuhan yang mendesak. Kita ambil, saya termasuk yang berdosa di situ. Tanpa malu mengatakan, saya termasuk yang berdosa tidak memenuhi amanah dari duo proklamator kita. Mengapa demikian? Dan ini kesalahan yang berjamaah. Perbuatan yang dibuat rame-rame. Rame-rame antara siapa? Legislatif, yudikatif, dan eksekutif. MPR ikut, DPD ikut, DPR ikut, dan pemerintah ikutan. Bagaimana cara mereka mengakali? Mengapa angka 20% itu tidak dipenuhi? Sehingga pendidikan kita alokasinya tetap kecil, kecil, dan kecil. 2018 misalnya, yang nomor wahid itu adalah Kementerian PU Pera, Perumahan Umum dengan segala macam infrastrukturnya, hard maupun soft. Kemudian nomor 2 adalah pantasnya apa ya? Kalau nomor 1 PU Pera infrastruktur, nomor 2 apa ya pantasnya? Ada yang mau teriak? Nomor 2 pantasnya apa? PU itu PU Pera, Pak. Infrastruktur. Nomor 2? No, pendidikan. Nomor 2 apa? No, udah kalah. Pertahanan dan keamanan. Hankam, bukan Hansip kampung, tapi maksudnya pertahanan dan keamanan. Jadi kita, kenapa itu bisa terjadi? Tentu alasannya kebutuhan. But how they play with the numbers so that there will not be against the clause stated in our constitutional act. Caranya adalah, karena berjamaah tadi ketemu caranya, yaitu keluarkan dulu kewajiban bayar utang. Itu udah hampir 40% dari alokasi dana kita itu untuk bayar utang. Hutang ya, pakai G. Kalau G-nya hilang, bagus, hutang. Tapi hutang. 40% dikeluarkan dulu, udah itu subsidi energi. Berapa persen subsidi energi kita? Subsidi energi itu termasuk listrik, termasuk bahan bakar minyak, itu adalah subsidi. Itu kira-kira akan memakan porsi APBN 20%. Jadi sisa 40 dari makan sama bayar utang, kewajiban bayar utang, pokok plus bunga, kemudian 20% bayar subsidi energi, sisa 40%. Dari 40% inilah baru diambil 20%-nya. Sehingga yang tadinya angka itu kelihatan besar menjadi kecil. Jadi persis bikin telur dadar pakai wajan yang lebar dan rata. Jadi lebar memang kelihatan tapi tipis. Enak sih dikasih kecap, dikasih cabai. Jadi itu yang menyebabkan mengapa, salah satu, bukan semuanya, salah satu mengapa pendidikan kita relatif jauh gitu kira-kira. Kalau pepatah Sumatera bilang, jauh panggang dari api. Jadi apa yang kita inginkan, itu masih jauh dari kenyataan. Ada faktor-faktor lain. Faktor lain adalah, pendidikan di Indonesia ini, hampir di semua tempat ada. Jadi makin lebar lagi itu telur tadi, wajannya makin besar. Contohnya, di Kementerian Pendidikan dan Kebudayaan, itu secara resmi ada struktur pendidikan. Mulai dari yang paling bawah, namanya apa? Sekolah resmi kita yang paling bawah namanya apa? Agak ketinggian tuh. Ada lagi PAUD, PAUD, ya kan? Ada PAUD, ada SD, ada SMP, ada SMA, ada SMK, Politeknik, perguruan tinggi atau universitas. Itu yang resmi. Tapi kalau Anda pindah zona, masuk ke Kementerian Agama, ada sekolah juga di situ. Saya mencoba menghafalnya berkali-kali, enggak pernah hafal. Mohon maaf. Sanawiyah apa namanya itu, saya mohon maaf. Jadi ada matchingnya. Kalau di resmi di Kementerian Pendidikan Kebudayaan ada dari PAUD sampai ke perguruan tinggi, di Kementerian Agama ada lagi. Belum lagi di kementerian-kementerian yang lain. Istilahnya pendidikan dinas. Sehingga pendidikan kita ini begitu melebar dengan dana yang relatif sedikit. Itu tantangan kita. Tapi sekali lagi, saya bukan tunjuk hidung, cari kambing hitam, tapi memang fakta yang mesti kita terima adalah pendidikan kita tertinggal. Itu satu. Tertinggal itu bisa dibongkar lagi, tertinggal apanya? Ada yang boleh pakai Human Development Index, kita tertinggal. Mau pakai Global Competence, kita juga tertinggal. Mau pakai apalagi terakhir, PISA, bukan menara itu. Kita juga tertinggal. Jadi indikator apa aja yang dipakai? Kita tertinggal. Apakah disengaja supaya kita tertinggal? Atau kita balik, kita cari indikator di mana kita menang? Saya pernah melakukannya dan alhamdulillah berhasil. Pada waktu saya diskusi dengan almarhum Umar Khayyam di UGM, saya mengatakan UGM bisa punya program studi nomor satu di dunia. Terus dia bilang, Mas, nano yo nano ne ojo ngono, itu kira-kira. Lo saya bilang bisa Pak, bikin prodi bahasa Jawa. Ya boleh aja ketawa Pak. Silahkan itu tertawakan, tapi ide itu akan memposisikan Indonesia nomor wahid. Emang ada yang lebih ahli dari kita tentang antropologinya, tentang bahasanya, fonetik, semua. Maka jadilah UGM sekarang punya program studi mulai dari S1 sampai S3 nomor 1 di dunia. Saya tiru ide itu juga di Bandung. Ada sebuah universitas, Universitas Pajajaran. Bikin program studi bahasa Sunda. Jadi itu cara kita berkelit supaya kita punya. Karena jadi juara itu penting dulu. Penting dulu. Juara dulu baru direplika. Karena itu kita sedang berusaha keras sekarang supaya silat diakui di Olimpiade. Supaya kita juara. Jadi itu penting untuk membangun rasa bangga. Itu yang saya pikir apa yang Anda lakukan di ruangan ini sekarang itu sedang mencari itu, di mana kita bisa juara. Cari celah, sekecil apapun celah itu, masuk ke situ dan jadilah juara. Baru diperbanyak. Saya ingat waktu ikut kursus di McDonald's University, kiatnya sama. Bikin satu yang bagus, nomor satu, baru replika, perbanyak. Sama kan, cari celah itu. Carilah medan laga di mana peluang untuk jadi juara besar. Susah pasti cari meja. Cari yang susah, kalau yang gampang ketemu pasti. Tapi kita gak juara, karena banyak orang di sana. Carilah medan laga di mana, ya saya pikir tanpa mengiklankan, dari papan sebelah kiri saya itu yang mereka lakukan. Cari celah. Terus jadi juara, baru perbesar. Tapi jangan lupa, memperbesar itu tidak pernah bisa linear. Y sama dengan AX plus B, itu cuma ada di buku. Dalam dunia kita bisa juga Y sama dengan AX plus B. Tapi di dalam A ada Y, ada X. Di dalam B ada X, ada A bahkan. Jadi sama rumusnya, tapi dia menjadi non-linear. Jadi hati-hati juga begitu membesarkan, kita lihat. Baik, itu yang kita teropong di Indonesia. Dari pengalaman saya misalnya, selama dari 2010 sampai sekarang, apa yang kami lakukan sama tentang human resource development, kompetensi dan karakter. Itu dua yang menjadi kata kunci di dalam mendapatkan orang yang cocok. Kalau hanya boleh memilih satu, syukur-syukur kompetensi dan karakter. Kalau sekiranya operator dan-nya dikendorkan, diganti dari the genius and menjadi the idiot or, jadi kompetensi atau karakter, pilih yang mana dulu? Kalau Anda di dalam posisi merekrut orang, kriteria pertama tentu carilah orang-orang yang punya kompetensi tinggi, berkarakter baik. Dan, kalau dan-nya itu kita lembutkan sedikit, bolehlah kompromi. Nah, ada dua kelompok orang, yang satu kompetensinya jago banget, karakternya. Kelompok yang kedua, kompetensinya yang begini, karakternya bagus. Pilih yang mana? Coba angkat tangan deh, pilih kelompok satu, kompetensinya super bagus, karakternya goyang. Kelompok dua, karakternya bagus, kompetensinya goyang. Pilih yang mana? Tapi, hati-hati ya, kalau nunjuk satu sama dua ini saya takut deh. Nah, you don't get the joke. You don't get the joke, Bara, Rafat, and Shara. Nah, we are now at the stage of president election will be next year. Only two candidates. One is using this, the other one is using this. So when I'm asking them, please don't use this or that. Otherwise, I'll be seen being the campaigner. Nah, gini pakai gini aja deh. Gini satu tangan kiri atau tangan kanan ya. Penetral kita lah, kita itu urusan orang lain aja lah, kita nggak ikutan. Who will choose the group of people with the high competence with shaky character? I call this left hand. Second one is the people with the potential to be improved competence but with the good character. Thank you so much. So, in this occasion, we are at the same page. Meaning, I prefer the person with the people with the good character, and yet the competence can be improved, not too low. If it is too low, then you cannot. Zero multiplied by whatever number is still zero, right? We are not seeking the zero, but possible to be improved. So that is really the essence of the book, latest book on time, talent, time and energy. They first look at the people with the talent, and then in what area that they are passionate in, and how they are spending their time and energy to improve their competence. With the assumption the character at the first place is correct. So that is really the case for us. Now allow me to see another word, another book, the very old book, the classic book. Even today, I think that book is still being used. That light mean my time is finished? Oh, okay. Okay, can you give me 1 minute or two? Okay, if bureaucrat ask for one, meaning five. No, allow me to finish my talk by inviting you to look at the very classical book written by, is it Donald Knuth? The Art of Programming. I always astonished by this book, 1, 2, 3, 4A. four books. The title is very, if you, okay, the inside, I don't want to talk to you about this, as if ngabejaan bulu tuur, kata orang Sunda, artinya you know that already. But I would like to invite you to read and dig further why the title of the book is chosen as The Art of Programming. Anybody been curious about the title, or you jump into the content directly? How about the title? The Art of Programming. The Art of Computer Programming. The two words there, art, which is hard part of the brain, right part of the brain, and then programming, which is left part of the brain. So the title is purposely selected as The Art of Programming because to balance your life, use your right brain, use your left brain. That is the so-called the make sense logics. Don't be like me, whereby my left hand has nothing right, my right brain has nothing left. I thank you very much for listening.